A graphic of the Perkins logo sweeps across the screen, revealing a chapter heading. Mapping the visual field with perimetry.
So we have to measure the visual field in a quantitative way, and we have to relate where you see the target in your peripheral field to a point in space that has some kind of metric that we can say it's 60 degrees from fixation. I can say, well, you see it right here and you don't see it here, but what's that difference? Is this 90 degrees? Is this 60, 70, and so forth? So we really need to quantify that, and we need it to be able to describe it to other people, to show it to previous exams, and to really follow how a person's visual field is holding together when they have a disease. We use something called a hemispheric perimeter. It's actually a white painted hemisphere, very smooth, completely simple inside. And now what the instrument will do is it projects a light onto that surface. And that light can appear in any place in the field. It can be moved, it can be static. You move the target, it's kinetic. And that was the old way of doing things, and we used something called a Goldmann kinetic perimeter to do that.
In a photograph, we see a hemispheric perimeter of the type described. Red arrows point to a chin and brow rests, which allow the head to remain in a steady position during testing, thus aiding focus on a fixation point at the center of the hemisphere, which is also noted by a red arrow. A bright point in the hemisphere is the light target, and it is also identified with an arrow. Next, we see the device from the back, with an examiner peering through a scope that extends from the interior fixation point. Using a Goldmann perimeter chart, the examiner can pick a point at which the light target will be presented inside the perimeter. The results are then plotted by the examiner.
The Goldmann has been superseded now for adults, for testing adults. So in most clinical settings with adults, they still use a hemispheric perimeter, but now everything is done with a target, the light being presented in one position, so statically. It's also automated, run by a computer. So there's no longer an examiner who has to do all of this positioning and plotting by hand. It's all done by a computer. So a person does the same thing they do with in the old version with a Goldmann. I didn't quite describe that, but puts their chin in a chin rest and their forehead against this, looking into the globe, watching a tiny, small central spot and waiting for the light to come.
In a photo, we see a young boy being tested by an examiner. His chin and forehead rest in a fixed position, and in his hand he grasps a buzzer. The examiner peers through the scope at the back of the machine.
When they see the light, they press a buzzer. So the same thing is done in the Goldmann and in the automated static perimetry, only the light moves in one situation and it doesn't in the other.
We see a photograph of a patient seated at an automated static perimeter device. In his right hand is the buzzer that he will depress when a target is sighted. Since only one eye is tested at a time, he wears a patch over his right eye. A screen displaying the plot results is visible on the side of the machine.
The reason why not moving the target, presenting it in one position, is really good. It's very precise, and you can vary the light, the brightness of that target, up and down, so you can see just how dim a target will that person be able to see. And that's really important for measuring fields in people who have optic nerve and retinal disease. Now, the Goldmann is still very good for testing the peripheral field, and it's also really good for testing children who can't sit for the amount of time it takes for an automated static perimetry test, pressing the buzzer, looking in, holding still, all of that. We can interact with the kid that we're testing with Goldmann. We can, you know, talk to them and say, oh, should we take a break? Do you want to try it this way? We try to make it into a game for them.
Fade to black.